CBS is proud to bring you this special presentation, 9/11. It is an historic eyewitness account from inside Ground Zero. This intimate portrayal of a life and death struggle for survival contains some strong language. 9/11 is presented by Nextel and will have limited interruptions.
Good evening. I'm Tim Donahue, President and CEO of Nextel Communications. Welcome to this special presentation of 9/11. Tonight we'll see a remarkable film that captures the extraordinary bravery of the firefighters that fought desperately to save lives at the World Trade Center. At Nextel, we've had the privilege of working with police, firefighters, and other rescue workers at Ground Zero and the Pentagon. We've witnessed firsthand their courage and conviction. It is our hope that sharing this presentation with the rest of America will honor these heroes as we remember the many victims of this tragedy. And so we present the next 2 hours commercial-free, with only three short breaks that will allow all of us to reflect on the contributions of the millions of public safety professionals across America who dedicate their lives to our safety. On behalf of Nextel Communications, CBS, and the Uniformed Firefighters Association Scholarship Fund, we invite you to remember their courage, their bravery, and their heroism.
Tonight, a new chapter in the most important story of our time.
The World Trade Center, we took a hit on that last explosion.
One firehouse.
We gotta get everybody out! Let's go!
Three filmmakers.
I saw the second one hit the other tower.
In a place you've never seen.
Battalion 1, Division 1, where are you, Steve?
On a day you'll never forget.
Command pulse. Tower 1, evacuate the building.
9/11.
Six months ago tomorrow, these streets of New York changed forever. We all remember where we were that September morning. We remember how we heard the news, what we felt, what we saw. Tonight, you're going to meet three young filmmakers who also witnessed what happened that awful day. Only they saw it from the inside, and it's a view the rest of us haven't seen until now. I'm Robert De Niro. Last year, two French brothers, Jules and Gédéon Naudet, set out to make a film about a rookie New York fireman. They had no idea they would become eyewitnesses to the defining event of our time, or that they would capture the courage of those who faced hell on earth, and the miracle of a lucky few who survived. The story begins last summer. With the help of a friend and firefighter, James Hanlon, the Naudet brothers were allowed to follow the men of Engine 7, Ladder 1. It's one of the oldest firehouses in New York, just a few blocks from here. For months, the material they shot was routine, uneventful. September 11th was no different, until 8:46 that morning. Engine 7, Ladder 1 was one of the first to arrive at the World Trade Center. Jules Naudet was with him, and his camera never stopped rolling. It's the only footage from inside Tower 1. What you're going to see has been edited with great care. Still, some of the language is rough. After all, these men had never been tested like this before. This is the story of how the city's bravest rose to their greatest challenge on September 11th.
When you work in a firehouse seven blocks from the two tallest buildings in New York, you get to know every step, every staircase, every story.
Morning, Jim. Couldn't get too close to that razor blade.
Oh. I'm James Hanlon. I've been a New York City firefighter for 9 years, at Ladder 1 downtown. Last summer, the summer before 9/11, there were days we'd go to the Trade Center five times in a single shift.
We're going to also send you some help.
My point is, We knew those towers as well as anybody. But nobody, nobody expected September 11th. On that day, guys from my firehouse, my best friends, were some of the first firefighters into Tower 1 after the plane hit. What they did that day, what everyone there did, was remarkable.
Chief!
And almost as remarkable, it was captured on videotape, inside the tower, beginning to end. And tonight, you'll see all of it. The tape was shot by two brothers, Jules and Gédéon Naudet.
Holy shit.
They're documentary filmmakers and old friends of mine.
I don't know. They always say there is always a witness for history, I guess. We were, that day, we were chosen to be the witness.
The strange thing is, the tape, the whole story, it kind of happened by accident. I mean, Jules and Gédéon didn't mean to make a documentary about 9/11. We wanted to make a documentary about a firefighter. That's how the whole thing got started.
9, 10, 1, 2, 3.
More to the point, the plan was to follow a rookie. On the job, we call them probies.
The idea was to show how a kid almost become a man in 9 months.
Which is their probationary period, where they have to prove themselves.
Let's go, guys, hurry up, get in the apartment.
We teamed up, and by last June, the three of us were out at the fire academy shooting the training.
Help.
And trying to decide which one of the 99 new probies would be the perfect probie.
My name's Paul Denver. John Carroll.
Antonios Benetatos. Tony for short.
I was a police officer.
For a while, I was a pizza man, actually, an Irish pizza man in the Bronx.
This is my first job. It sounds kind of cheesy, but I always kind of wanted to be a hero, and this is really the only thing you could do that you can do that.
Immediately, we're like, okay, this is the kid. This is the kid. Let's go.
We got Tony assigned to my firehouse, one of the biggest in the city. It's Ladder 1, plus a whole other company, Engine 7.
I'm so glad I took this job. Can't beat it.
That's what it says.
They are the greatest, incredible guys.
They're guys who fought some of the worst fires you can imagine.
What's up with that shirt?
What's the matter?
Soon, they'd face the unthinkable. Question was, would Tony be ready?
I'm terrified. This is what I want to do, but it's scary. I just hope I can do everything that I'm supposed to do. You know, I'm still worried about how I'm going to actually react when there's fire flying over my head. Here goes.
What's your first name?
Tony.
You come in on Thursday, right?
Thursday? I wasn't sure of that.
Thursday night.
I am now, sir.
Do you want, need to sit down?
Thank you.
You want to stop calling me sir?
I'm a little bit nervous.
All right.
I want to make sure I do everything I'm supposed to do.
Thing is, when you're a probie, what you're supposed to do.
We gotta do the sheets, we change the sheets in the mornings.
It's pretty much everything.
More news and traffic coming up. It's 6:22. Oh, I got work to do.
Get all the wheels, then we start up top and we wash the rig down.
You have an iron at home?
Actually, I do not. Sir.
We're all being in a lot of trouble. Take two.
I think I'm doing decently. You know, I'm still waiting for a fire. That's all. Just waiting for a fire. And I think that'll you know, make a pretty big difference.
Engine.
Matter. Should we grab that big long thing from the back too?
Thing is, guys say there's two kinds of probies. Fire's
out. Getting closer.
Black clouds and white clouds. When a black cloud comes to the firehouse, that probie, he brings all the fires in the city with him. White cloud, just the opposite. No fires.
Don't get me wrong, there were fires. Just not when Tony was on duty. The kid was one very white cloud.
Tony was nervous, of course. Terribly nervous. And as the days would pass, Tony, waiting for his first fire, wanted to prove to the other guys, and even more to himself, that he was going to be a real great fireman.
Tony! Yeah.
The guys were not going to make it easy on him.
No one was singling Tony out. We do it to every probie.
We're going to break your chops till you laugh about it.
Right.
Because that's how we do it. All right. We'll tease you to death until you start laughing.
Right. No problem.
You gotta love this show.
No, I...
Sooner or later, and you will. Yeah.
But before you can love it, you've got to learn it.
Now, say you got up there now, got your helmet on, your bunker gear, and you got to get your mask on. How are you going to do that? Without letting go?
I don't know.
Okay, stop moving, guys. Hot in here, hurry up, make a quick sweep, it's hot.
The next time you do this, you're gonna be more cautious.
Right.
You're fine. Right. All I want you to do is learn to relax.
Okay.
Not bad.
No.
Not bad. And that handwriting's getting better already.
Thank you.
Hey, Dave, today, baby.
Yes. Okay, thank you. For 2 weeks, I got $672.25.
Oh, you gotta be kidding me. You couldn't even buy a six-pack with that. Holy crap.
It's starting pay, you know? If I wanted to get rich, I would have become a lawyer. But I wanted something that I'd be able to live with for the rest of my life. This I can live with.
A lot of the guys feel that way.
You need to get up in the morning and look yourself in the mirror and say you're doing something with your life.
Somebody's in there. Hit the door.
You do your job, you risk your life to help people. And to be part of a family at the firehouse.
Just making some onions and mushrooms for the steaks.
How you doing, Jamal, huh? You doing pretty good?
Yeah?
Here we go.
Ah, oh, this is a good song here. Oh,
whoa, 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 whoa.
Tell me one other job where everyone sits down to dinner together every night.
Now, Steve, you gotta be tired now.
Let me help you, Steve, because I think I'm the only guy that helps you in this firehouse.
Hey,
been 4 weeks, I think. 5 weeks, something like that. And I'm still no fire. But it'll come. Probably when I'm asleep and not ready for it, that's when it'll come.
2:30 in the morning, bro. You can sleep, you can.
All right.
Trust me, when the alarm goes off, they'll come and get you.
I'm kidding.
Shut down, Finn!
I got the spray water. You're getting closer.
There you are, Tony. Look, your first fire. And it was a car fire, no less.
That's all right. My first fire was a garbage can fire on West Broadway in Franklin.
Listen, Tony was getting closer. But for the record, that was some flame. It wasn't a real fire.
Hey, Chief, come see his first fire.
If they're all like that, it's going to be a fun 20 years.
Hey, there's fire over here. Here's the fire, see? Stretch a line, put out the stakes.
By the end of August, we knew that we had a great cooking show, and there were no fires.
Waiting for a job. That was a very big concern. But every time we would talk with some of the senior guys, they always told us, well, be careful what you wish for.
Yesterday, a 27-year-old firefighter in Staten Island, he was stationed, went to a job, and he passed away. We'll go to the funeral on Saturday, and what can you say?
I look back to last summer, and it doesn't just seem like a different time. It seems like a different world. At the time, we didn't think there could be anything worse than losing a single firefighter. I mean, looking back, we were kind of innocent, especially Tony.
A bunch of the guys were talking about what different parts usually get them at the funeral. When the coffin went past, that was a little rough. I hope it's my last one.
But go straight up right now. There's a lot of things going on at all times, you know? Shit's hitting the fan, the roof starts to collapse, you gotta get off. You know, you gotta really improvise.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
Basically, you have to be on the top of your game.
Right.
You're not the OV, you're on the top of your game. This is not a joke, this job. You know?
Right.
It's a lot of things to think about, you know? And tunnel vision, focus, really, because that's what's gonna keep you alive, and that's what's gonna give you the opportunity to help anybody else.
Right.
Ready to go down?
Fire or no fire, Tony had learned a lot that summer. Sure, he had a ways to go, but we'd teach him. Far as we knew, there was plenty of time. A few days later, Jules cooked a French dinner for the guys. At least he tried to.
Decided to cook leg of lamb, which I told him for a long time was one of my specialties.
I think he cooked one, and we really needed at least five.
Where's Frenchie? A couple more meals like this, we'll be able to share shirts.
All right, I got a small piece, so what? Not my mistake.
We stayed up late, just telling jokes and busting chops.
This is it, that's all that's left.
This is the best part of the meat.
Even though the guys were making fun of us because we didn't cook enough, we're all having a great time. We're getting accepted.
We all joked all night long. It was really a great night. Little did we know.
It was the night of September 10th.
Presented by Nextel.
Good evening. I'm Tom Ridge. You're about to witness a remarkable display of courage. Faced with the worst, the firefighters of Engine 7 Ladder 1 gave us their best. But the heroism shown on 9/11 happens every day in every corner of America. Our firefighters, law enforcement officers, and EMTs are doing their duty to secure our homeland. It is our duty to support them. President Bush, working with Congress, is moving forward on a national homeland security strategy to give first responders, like these firefighters, the equipment, training, and communications they need. We will build up our public health system to combat bioterror, use technology to help secure our airports and borders, and work to get law enforcement the information it needs to stop a terrorist attack before it happens. The best way to honor the victims of 9/11 is for all of us to show our best. Contact USA Freedom Corps to find out ways to serve. Thank you.
Firemen live to help others live. It's that simple. Every day they wait for the call. Every day that passes without that alarm is a blessing and a burden. They know it's only a matter of time until they'll have to put their lives on the line. So they wait and they wonder. For the men of Engine 7, Ladder 1, the waiting and the wondering had lasted all summer. By early September, the filmmakers had captured so much about life around the firehouse, except for one thing, a big fire. There's a superstition among firemen. When you go too long without any fire, be prepared. Something big is coming. What you're about to see is how brave men work under stress, surrounded by chaos. They trained all their lives for this moment, but nothing could have prepared them for what was about to happen.
Splendid September day. The afternoon temperature about 80 degrees. Great weather for the primary election. Tonight, clear and cool, low 60.
It's begun to sound like some sort of a cliche. But really, September 11th started out like every other day. 8 o'clock in the morning.
Don't throw the fat away.
The day guys were just coming in. I was off that day. 13 guys from my firehouse were on.
Around 8:30.
Engine, ladder.
I believe the run came in.
Get the run for the gas leak, or an odor of gas in the street, actually, I think it was.
It's just Lispinard and Church, odor of gas.
Yeah, I don't think anything of it. You get on the rig, you go, you say, all right, it's an odor of gas.
Jules was riding with the battalion chief, Joseph Pfeiffer, videotaping.
It was just another call. Riding was the battalion chief.
It was basically camera practice. See, Jules had only been shooting for a few weeks. Before that, Gédéon was the main cameraman.
Every time the battalion goes, I go. You know, I just need to practice, so I shoot. And I don't stop.
Yes, means right here.
We check the area with meters. And it was kind of routine.
It was 8:46 in the morning. That's when this stopped even resembling a normal day.
Then and there, I knew that this was going to be the worst day of my life as a firefighter.
Go to the Trade Center.
Immediately, I knew that this wasn't an accident.
Oh, my God. That looked like a direct attack. What?
Chief Pfeiffer made the first official report.
We have a number of floors on fire. It looked like the plane was aiming towards the building. Transmit a third alarm. We'll have the staging area at Vesey and West Street.
It was probably a two-minute ride, but it seemed like it was forever because there was a lot of things going through your head. Everyone in this pass and was looking up. It's like the world just stopped.
We are just currently getting a look at the World Trade Center. We have something that has happened here. Flame and an awful lot of smoke from one of the towers. Whatever has occurred has just occurred within minutes. And we are trying to determine exactly what that is.
Right in there?
No,
right in front.
As we swung around in front of World Trade, my mind tells me, wow, this is bad.
What do we do? Like, what do we do for this?
We park right under the awning of One World Trade Center. Chief Pfeiffer puts his gear on, and I remember asking him, you know, Chief, can I come in with you? I want to come in with you. And he says, yep.
Yeah, you stay with me.
Come in with me, never leave my side.
We got the chair.
I go in. And I hear screams, and right to my right, there is two people on fire, burning. I just didn't want to film that. It was like, no one should see this.
Pfeiffer was the first chief into the building. Right away, a guy from the Port Authority told him the damage was somewhere above the 78th floor. But all you had to do was look around. It was obvious. Something had happened right there in the lobby.
You just saw that all the windows were blown out.
The lobby looked like the plane hit the lobby.
Later, they figure out that flaming jet fuel had shot straight down the elevator shaft.
All of this damage was done already. People was all over the place. So you knew it was going to be worse when we got upstairs.
Flames are shooting out. Smoke is pouring out.
I want you to get an engine and team up. Just get an outside line. Walk to 7. Okay, I want you to don't go any higher than 70. What's going on?
My main concern was we had, you know, 20 floors of people above.
Chief, do you have any idea where the floors are?
And we had to figure out a way to get them out. As it turned out, we had no usable elevators.
With the elevators out, there was only one way to get up there. Walk.
Companies come in. You see them with a concerned look on their face. And they're sent up.
Firefighter in full gear, carrying 60-something pounds of hose and equipment. Takes about a minute to climb one flight of stairs. These guys were looking at 80 stories just to get there. Then they'd start working.
I felt the mood that we were gonna put the fire out. Everyone seemed to be confident. I know I was.
You basically looked at it and said, okay, we got 10, 20 stories of fire. You know, we'll deal with it. We'll get up there. You know, we'll get to it.
There are fire crews just screaming into this area from every conceivable direction.
By this time, some of the top chiefs in the department had joined Chief Pfeiffer, running the command post, sending guys upstairs.
Every time I looked around, it was new faces. Some that I recognized. I had seen Chief Pronti, great guy, white hair, mustache, the perfect grandfather that you'd like to have. I remember seeing Lieutenant Fodi, who was working with 9 Engine. Said hello and then started going up.
Another of the men who went up was Lieutenant Kevin Pfeiffer. He was in charge of Engine 33, and he was the chief's brother.
I just remember we both looked at each other, said a few words, but it was more the look with a real concern that this was going to be something tough.
It's going to be a tough job. It's going to be a long job. They'll put it out. That's what they do.
The last time Jules had seen his brother was an hour ago at the firehouse. Far as Jules knew, Gédéon had followed Tony, the probie, into the tower.
When we had left for the odor of gas in the street, for me, it was in the engine. And then when we arrived to the Trade Center, he went up immediately with the guys. So for me, my brother is going up the stairs.
It turns out Gédéon was with Tony.
Engine 7, ladder 1. This is firefighter Benitatis.
But Tony was still at the firehouse.
Yeah. No, I was off duty.
And now he'd been ordered to stay there.
Everybody's been recalled. All available units must come back to the firehouse.
While Tony tried to keep up with the phones,
this is firefighter Benitatis.
Gédéon took his camera and started walking down towards the Trade Center. He was sure his brother was inside, and he wanted to get to him.
I remember slowly walking down to the World Trade Center. What really stuck in my mind is passing by the people and filming them and filming their astonishment. And the eyes saying, this is not happening. And remember tilting the camera back and forth between the people and the tower in front of me.
Of the World Trade Center have been hit by aircraft. Both are in flames.
There is black smoke coming from both of the towers. It's a horrific scene here. There's debris flying through the air.
Mayday.
There were two planes. I saw the second one hit. It hit the other tower.
What we knew was that a second plane hit. And we had a lot of people trapped.
Stay together. You know what's going on. We're just gonna have to walk. We have one way to go. Second plane is missing. Motherfuckers.
Now the chiefs would have to set up a whole other operation over in Tower 2.
I'm gonna send him up. I get no chief.
The second plane hit, that's when you could see fear.
Both of them are on fire.
You could see it in everybody's eye.
Tell your co-workers away.
There were people from all over the world in these streets. Different colors, different languages. On those few blocks between the firehouse and the World Trade Center, the entire world was there.
So two aircraft. The first one on one World Trade Center. The second one just happened.
And they were all looking at the same thing and talking about the same thing and reacting the same way.
Is it a plane? You saw a plane going? A plane went straight into the building, right there, into the side. A plane? Yes. How big is the plane?
That was a direct hit.
That's a huge one.
That was
a number two planes?
Yeah.
There's two. One in each building.
Yeah, I saw the last one.
We are boom in the whole building. What are those people going to do?
On the second one?
All the elevators are blocked out.
Yeah.
Well, the staircases must still be. No. Right?
Stairs were crowded. People were coming down burnt.
Upstairs in Tower 1, the guys from my firehouse were now 10 floors up and climbing.
If we did talk, it was to the people coming down, trying to comfort them, tell them it's all right, get out, stay calm.
I wound up finding a woman in the C staircase. Her arms were all burnt. She was just sitting there, basically in shock. So I picked her up under her arms, and I put her in with a group of guys, and I asked the group of guys to, you know, take it down.
I knew we had to get up to help people. We had to get up there. People pretty much said, why are y'all going up there? Get out.
Their concern was to get everybody out. That was the key. as much people out as possible.
Most of the people in Tower 1 came out on the mezzanine above the lobby. Then they'd get out through another building.
All right, I want to use the lobby of 7 as a triage.
The chiefs didn't want anyone going through the lobby doors. First, it was because debris was falling outside. Then, it was people falling.
You don't see it, but you know where it is.
What's that?
And you know that every time you hear that crashing sound, it's a life which is extinguished. It's not something you could get used to. And the sound was so loud.
I just remember looking up, thinking, how bad is it up there that the better option is to jump?
Investigating reports of a plane hijacking before these crashes we're telling you about at the World Trade Center towers this morning.
Pieces of the building and the planes actually landed blocks away.
Please don't stop walking, Mr. Harry, please!
Gédéon was walking with his camera when he found a chunk of the plane engine that had crashed completely through Tower 2. That was as close as Gédéon would get to the Trade Center, without a firefighter anyway.
So I decided that the smartest thing to do was to slowly walk back to the firehouse and find a way to go to Jules.
We're just getting word now. One of the two planes was hijacked after takeoff from Boston. This is
two airplanes have crashed into the World Trade Center in an apparent terrorist attack on our country.
We now have reports of a fire at the Pentagon. Fire at the Pentagon being reported this morning.
I was just saying that the officials are calling this an act of terrorism. They're saying that's clearly what it is, clearly not an accident.
Arriving back at the firehouse, and Tony is still alone, and he has no clue of what to do.
The Pentagon's on fucking fire? War. This is war.
And just by listening to him, freaking out and swearing and behaving like I've never seen him behaving, Tony was expressing what we all felt. At that point, I saw the fireman in him taking over.
I can't believe the fucking Pentagon. Somebody has balls.
I mean, a few times he was just pulling his gear and about to rush to the door and realizing that he was the only one in charge of this empty firehouse. And going back to the house watch and looking again at those pictures on TV and just to make sure that it was real.
These two enormous explosions at the World Trade Center here.
Tony just wanted to go there.
In the lobby, the chiefs were trying to run the largest rescue operation any of them had ever seen. With next to no information coming in from outside.
You got a phone that's working?
I think the entire world knew more than we did. Everybody had seen the attacks. Everybody had seen the tower burning.
Had
seen the Pentagon. For us, we didn't have a clue of what was going on outside our lobby. Feels like a beehive, that place. Everybody's working on the phone, everybody's working on the radio. Everybody's getting information, sending guys up, getting reports. and just trying to get this thing under control.
At one point, there was even a rumor a third plane was heading in. You got to remember, at that moment, anything seemed possible.
Other than NYPD, Port Authority, police, and the military. And I need that done now.
Another fucking plane. All that strategy is to get as many people out of the fucking building, let it burn up.
On top of everything else, just talking to the guys in the stairwells was tough.
Four David to Battalion 7.
The tower's internal communication setup had been knocked out by the crash. That left fire department radios.
Suddenly, you have hundreds and hundreds of firefighters that have radios. Seems to become more and more difficult.
Please provide me again with your location.
Is there anyone in this car?
Which one is that?
Is there anyone in this car?
We had one guy from the WTC who was trying frantically to reach anyone on the elevators.
69 car, anyone in this car? Oh, is there anyone in this car?
And going through the list.
Hello, is there anyone in this car?
And there's about 98 elevators in the World Trade Center.
Is there any kind of recall capability to try to
fire? I can't speak.
I'm trying to evaluate which one's
in. In the middle of all this, suddenly an elevator opens up. And you see people. Not having a clue of what's going on. Because they've been stuck in there since the first plane hit. Are we seeing the look on the firefighters?
I don't know. I'm jumping out of here like...
It was not fear, it was... What's going on? Disbelief. That made me panic a little bit. That made me panic. It was the first time I had seen Father Judge, the chaplain, as he's called.
He was in the lobby with us, and I could tell that he was praying. You know, Father Judd, he would at least make eye contact with you and kind of give you a reassuring look. That wasn't occurring, almost like he knew that this was not good.
Back at the firehouse.
What's up?
Off-duty guys were starting to show up.
You know, Paul, we're just waiting right now.
What's that?
We're just waiting right now.
Tony was, he just had one thing in his mind.
This is bad.
To go there, and he couldn't.
Two fifth alarms right away.
And that's when Chief Burns arrived.
I need a couple of coffee.
Larry Burns joined the fire department in 1957, retired a battalion chief 3 years ago.
I couldn't wait. I had to get down there. Because you know what? They're my firefighters. It's my building. It's my city.
Leave your gear all together, get a flashlight, and a bottle of water.
Okay.
Told the probie, get your gear, let's go.
I remember Tony asking me to bring him some gloves, medical gloves.
Grab a box of gloves. Go grab a box of gloves.
And by the time I found them and rushed back, they were gone.
Oh my
Proby and the retired chief were lost in the crowd, headed down to the Trade Center.
I think at that point, the lobby was pretty empty. There were just a few of us in the lobby, and we were discussing tactics.
This is Tower One.
Put a big one here. Some of the outlying companies didn't know what Tower One was and Tower Two. So we were just trying to help them out by writing it on the desk to make it obvious to people.
It was just before 10 o'clock. A little over an hour since the first plane hit. Firefighters from all over the city were inside those towers. Hundreds of them.
I remember I'm filming Chief Pfeiffer, and he's on the radio.
Situation that started bad just gets worse and worse and worse. The World Trade Center, South Tower, which was hit by a plane and wrecked by an explosion approximately an hour ago, has totally collapsed.
What happened?
If you're just joining us this morning, you're in for a horrific surprise.
Just one right out of one of the movies you would see in Hollywood. People walking around with cell phones in tears, holding their heads, looking up at what's left of the World Trade Center and just shaking their heads in disbelief.
Out on the street, everyone knew what just happened. The South Tower was gone. They saw it collapse and ran.
Waited. Time slowed down and everything became pitch black.
Everybody all right?
Yeah, I'm okay.
How's the way out of here?
And then realized, okay, I'm not dead.
Yeah, right here.
So let's turn on my floodlight on top of my camera.
All right, come on down this way. Yeah, let's get out the way we came in.
Okay, come on back. Everybody down.
Inside the Trade Center, all Jules and Chief Pfeiffer knew.
Yeah, right here.
All anyone knew was that something had gone terribly wrong.
They asked me, you with the light, help us out.
We gotta get everybody out!
Was pointing my light wherever they needed. I remember seeing Chief Pfeiffer.
Air Pulse from Tower 1, all units, evacuate the building. Command post to all units.
He gave it right away, very calm, didn't wait. And it was, for him, it was a precaution. It was, okay, something wrong is happening. Let's get everybody out.
Where's that flashlight?
From the tone of his voice, I knew that it was no normal thing. I knew it was time to leave.
I remember saying to the guys, well, we're on our own now.
And for the first time, I looked in someone else's eyes and saw fear. Whew. Which you don't see with the firemen.
We orderly evacuated.
Well, it was such a long walk, 21, 17, 16, 15, 14, 13.
And I was going down the stairs. I can remember a fireman resting on the landing and telling them, you know, We've heard of Mayday, get out of the building. I don't think they, a lot of them, I know for a fact, did not take it serious.
Sarge?
I was not even consciously filming. I was just had my camera by my side and pointing the light wherever they needed.
Sorry.
Needed my light to actually help someone, and then I realized it was Father Judge.
Hey guys, here, we need a hand.
We saw him lying at the base of the escalator where we were. And I removed his white collar and I opened up his shirt. And I remember checking for his pulse and realizing at that time he was gone.
All right, we got four guys. Top of the escalator. Top of the escalator.
Top of the escalator.
After that, we had to figure out how to get out of where we were.
If you go out this way, right where we are now, people are still jumping, debris is still falling, and it's too dangerous. You cannot go out this way.
From World Trade Center, we took a hit on that last explosion. Which way?
Chief Pfeiffer tells the people carrying Father Judge, okay, stay here.
Which way?
I told him that I'll be back and wait here and I'll see if the bridge is still here.
Chief Pfeiffer went to check one of the footbridges leading out of the Trade Center. If it was still standing, it'd be their best way out.
And now I wonder for the first time if Julie's still alive. I never thought about it before.
It's a terrible, terrible day. I'm sure they're having.
I realized that Jules could be dead that very moment. And I was feeling so responsible. I was the one who put him in this situation. I had to find June.
Gédéon hitched a ride with three off-duty firemen, determined to get to the Trade Center the only way they could, in a pickup truck.
You shouldn't have even come in here, man. Division 1.
We walk and we walk and we walk. And there are Maydays being given, and we start to figure out, okay,
we should be able to get out here.
It's much be worse than we think, because you cannot have that many Maydays and all that dust and that noise.
That's when I felt the danger for the first time. It was all around you. I mean, every single cell of your body was telling you, you know, you should not be here. The scenery was radically different. I mean, it was this white powder everywhere.
Take yourself as mask.
We get masked, we get an extra cylinder, and I'm gonna go in.
Just a few people here and there. And this kind of silence.
We have ambulances straight down. Thank
of course, sir, there's no word on casualties.
We have ambulances straight down.
But suffice to say, the loss of life, presumably profound.
Ambulances straight down. Ambulances straight down.
Of course, at this point, everyone's concern is just getting north, getting away from the World Trade Center, as well as finding out where their families are.
The south tower of the World Trade Center just minutes ago collapsed to the ground. Only one tower is standing at this point.
I have a direct line of sight to what is left of the World Trade Center. The fire continues to burn. I can see the flames through the thick smoke.
By this time, Chief Pfeiffer had found a safe exit and tried to radio the men in the lobby. No answer.
So we walked across the bridge back towards the Trade Center. Still trying to call on the radio and not getting through.
The guys that we had left there, they're not there anymore.
They had already gone out another way, carrying the body of Father Michael Judge down the street to St. Peter's Church. They laid his body on the altar. Father Mike's death certificate is number 00001, the first official casualty of the attacks. The chief, his aide Eddie Fahey, and Jules walked outside, underneath the footbridge they just crossed, and into a scene that none of them could even comprehend.
And there's debris everywhere. There's dust covering the entire place. And we look, and the tower's here. So we say, okay. Probably to something else. The tower is nice. It's standing. The other one, we can't see it, but it's probably just, you know, on the other side, and no one tells us. We have no clue. So we walk north.
Just trying to figure out what took place here, and then try to gain some control. And then was it just a sense that this wasn't a good place to stay.
Chief Pfeiffer's priority was to set up a new command post and find his men. Right now, they were coming down the stairs.
At some point, I started to run. I don't know, even know if I was touching stairs on my way down. When I got about to 3 or 2 is when I started to think of my family. So I gotta get out of here. When we reached the lobby, I joked about it. I said the command post was abandoned. The board was set up and nobody was there. I said, oh, this is not a good sign.
Yeah.
I knew there was nothing I could really do. I mean, I was not a fireman. I had absolutely no medical expertise at all, as just a civilian. But as a cameraman, yeah, there was something I could do. And it was to document what was happening. So the cameraman took over and just filmed.
Gédéon had made his way as close to the tower as he could.
Strange enough, the only thing that was my preoccupation was to clean my lens.
Jules was with Chief Pfeiffer. who was plotting his next move. The firefighters from my house had reached the lobby and scattered.
You know, kind of walking at this point. We knew we were out of the building, felt we were safe.
Unfortunately, there were people jumping out of windows. You could see them hitting the ground all around you, debris hitting the ground.
Get yourself accounted for with Chief Corey down at staging. Let's move. Come on, officers.
Basically, everybody was standing right in the shadow of Tower 1. It was 10:28 in the morning.
And this huge roar.
And I don't even have time to think at that point. I just run. Then I feel someone jumping on top of me, and then the dust.
I realized that I was going to die.
We need help!
And the only thing I could think about was Jules. And I remember telling myself that if I would survive that, I would be a better brother.
Let's go before the car blew up!
This way!
And it's dead silence. It's nothing. No radio calls, no sound, nothing. And I feel the person who was on top of me get up.
Get out of here. Yeah. You with me?
Yeah. And I recognize it's Chief Pfeiffer's voice. And I just realized it's just, you know, it jumped on top of me to protect me from all this.
Put those hands up.
Is that okay? What are the old boss for?
Chief Pfeiffer say, okay, let's go now. And we get up. The dust starts to clear because the wind was blowing in the opposite direction.
After that, it was just trying to literally walk around the block and regroup and walk back to the scene and see what we could do.
No. Moses!
Shit. Do you have some water, something to drink?
Open your mouth. Open your mouth, because I need the water too.
I had been in this street three times in the last hour. The first time, it was full of people. The second time, everybody was running away from it. And the third time, getting out of the last collapse, there was just nobody. And everything was white. Everything was covered by the dust.
Holy shit.
It was the most surreal scene I have ever seen. I cannot describe what took place.
It is a scene just not to be believed. The smoke's still billowing. What we do have is a lockdown. You can't get in, you can't get out, you can't go up, you can't go down.
I see that I'm still in the middle of the street, and I see there is a little deli. Seems to be open in the corner.
Yeah, we're getting O2 now.
Oh, okay. Come on in, guys.
A lot of people injured. Firefighters, bloody nose, things like that. And then it hits me. But now, where is my brother? I start realizing that I've probably lost my brother. So I try to go back to the World Trade Center. I need to go find my brother.
Where are the guys?
I have no idea. Where's Mr. Chief Pfeiffer?
And I'm in the middle of the street walking, and a cop approached me and says, you know, who are you with?
I'm with the chief of Battalion 1.
Oh, you're Battalion 1?
Yes.
You got an ID?
I don't have an ID. I have my letter of, from the commissioner.
Take your letter and your camera and get out of here. All right? Go.
So I go back up, walk north, not really knowing where I'm going.
Police department?
No, they're making a documentary on the fire department.
Come on, this ain't fucking Disneyland. Let's go.
And after a while, I said, you know, there's nothing I can do here. I need to go back to the firehouse. Maybe they'll have some news. And
no.
Maybe he's already back there. But at that point, I think he's dead. And it becomes too overwhelming.
Walking back to the firehouse and not trying to think for 1 second about troops. That was too much.
Don't worry, honey. We're family.
Everyone's asking me, what happened? I said, hell. Hell is what happened. It just came down. And it wasn't supposed to come down.
It's not easy being a survivor.
Little to little, the guys started to come back, one by one.
Can't explain why I'm here and there's so many dead. Very emotional. A lot of guys are crying.
So many thoughts and emotions. And
The way we lucked out, we were in one. Two fell first, then they told us to get out. Two fell first?
I can't figure this out.
One didn't fall first.
That's why they were getting us out. We got to call our loved ones, tell them we were okay.
It was fucking sick. But we just got out. I got up two blocks, and I'm like, I'm still not far enough. I got to run this thing.
So, you know, you just needed to be with... with the guys, you know?
I couldn't get back in. They wouldn't put me off.
I was never so glad to see firemen in my life. It was a great thing to know that... that people were surviving this.
I thought you guys were dead.
Not the only ones.
I thought I was dead.
That was the scariest thing. I came out.
It's like, oh my God, am I glad to see you.
We were the lucky ones.
I don't think it's luck. I mean, it's a miracle that we're here.
Miracle isn't a word you hear much from firefighters, especially not on that day. But what else could you call it? One guy after another was making it back safe.
Down here looking.
I got thrown into two ambulances. We bolted and ran.
I can't believe we all made it out. How did we make it out of that building? 30 seconds. Another two flights higher.
Again, the cameraman would just film them coming back and asking them if they had seen Jules. And nobody could answer this question. It was extremely frustrating and annoying. One guy from the firehouse came to me and I asked him, you know, have you seen Jules? I mean, do you know where he is? And he looked at me and he said, yes, he's behind you. And I turned over and Jules was there in the firehouse. I didn't even see him coming in. And it was like meeting for the first time.
Hein? Écoutez-moi, moi j'étais en vie, je savais pas si tu étais dans le camion, mais je les voyais pas au début.
Ah, Jules, if he's all right. He tells me yes. He tells me that he was all that time in the lobby.
I tell him, I know now what it's like to think you're going to die. And then I tell him, I got the first plane, and I filmed, and do you have enough tape?
Unbelievable.
Good to see you. All right, you okay?
Yeah.
Yeah, close?
Under.
Yeah, okay, good. All right, you're all right.
And it definitely was a miracle, you know?
Oh, fuck, man. We're worried about you. You don't know what happened to you guys. Oh, God. Everybody's all right. Everybody's accounted for.
Right here.
Got everybody? Everybody's accounted for?
Everybody come back one by one to the firehouse.
You all right? What's up, Patty?
Except one.
Did you see Tony over there by the tunnels?
Tony.
Yeah, that's what I heard.
Here we were, all accounted for, except for Tony. Everybody was wondering about Tony.
Nine-Eleven, presented by Nextel.
Hi, my name is Steve Buscemi. Before becoming an actor, I had the privilege of working alongside many heroes when I was a New York City firefighter for 4 years. A scholarship fund has been established for the families of New York City firefighters. Your gift can help shape the future of children, many of whom have suffered the tragic loss of their fathers. So please join me in making a contribution to the Firefighter Scholarship Fund. And the next time you see a firefighter, police officer, or EMT, please thank them for their service to us all.
Thank you.
there is not anything recognizable of what were the two trade towers, nothing standing out from those clouds of dust at this time.
You guys were in the building? Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, that day changed everything.
I think I got fibers in there. You got fibers in there.
When I came back that day to the firehouse, one firefighter came to me and he said, you know, yesterday you had one brother. Today you have 50.
It's good to see you.
It's hard to even describe the emotions in the firehouse that day.
And it was just like, you heard the ground rumble, and it was just fucking debris was just chasing you. We were running, hauling ass. I mean,
fuck. On one hand, you're celebrating.
Very frightful day, man.
Very happy to be here.
Somehow the guys from our house, they got out.
I'm in the engine.
We lost so much that in that 2 hour period.
And you doing all right?
And we felt like we got the hell kicked out of us.
Shot, I don't know what to do, man. Go back down there or what? Fucking get shot. Yeah.
At the same time, we knew hundreds of firefighters, thousands of people had to have died in those towers. And every hour that passed, we were more certain Tony Benitatos was one of them.
Hey guys, Deputy Chief Hill called. First Division, he doesn't want anybody else down here right now.
Everybody was wondering about Tony. James just put his gear and went by himself to look for Tony.
I'd come in from home, and yeah, we were ordered to stay at the firehouse. But after 6 hours, somebody had to go and look for this kid.
Hold on! It's gone, man.
17 down?
I got down there just as 7 World Trade finally collapsed.
Hey, Rick, they've been going live with you the whole time.
No sign of Tony anywhere. It had to be almost 6 o'clock. 9 hours after everything started,
hey, Benitatos!
That Tony just walked in.
I walked in like a daze, and they were all like, hey, it's Benitatos, you're all right.
What's wrong with your hand, anything?
No.
Yeah, you all right?
Yeah.
Chill out.
How are you doing?
Good. You okay?
Yeah, I'm all right. What happened on your end?
I was in the building.
Were you? Is everyone from the house?
Everyone?
And then I just asked, did everyone get back? And they were like, yeah. That felt pretty good.
You motherfuckers, man. I was so sure you dudes were dead. I'm fucking digging through shit. And you fuckers are chilling here eating oranges? And I'm roaming around looking for you.
The last one that went out there, came back, and we were all okay.
I left here right after the first collapse.
Turns out, Tony had been with Larry Burns the whole time, the probie and the retired chief. They were right there when Tower 1 came down.
I checked all the rigs. There were rigs crushed, paramedic trucks covered with rubble, flipped, fires burning everywhere, huge fires. That whole day, I just searched through rubble, lifting things up, checking underneath.
It was hard for him. Just very hard for him. He's only been a firefighter for, you know, a couple of months. But he proved himself that day to all the guys, yeah.
There was so much that we didn't know about that first day. Who had attacked us, how, why. All we knew is that nothing would ever be the same.
And then, of course, the images of the replay that never stops, of the planes hitting, the towers coming down. And it was like, okay, enough TV. Thankfully, the power went out about that time, so it was a relief.
This generator may be in the courtyard, and then we'll hook the lights into it. I got two more sets of lights coming.
The entire downtown Manhattan lose power. It was really this feeling that we're going to be there for a long time.
Most of us stayed at the firehouse that night, trying to take it all in.
The roof of the Marriott, we were on the roof of the Marriott. There was parts all over the fucking place. Legs, feet, it was nasty.
You all right, brother?
Yeah, I'm all right. One of the things that sticks with me more than everything I saw is I sat down next to Ted. He looked real bad. I said, Tony, man, it was raining bodies. And just the way he said it, man, it just, the man had been through hell.
Good evening. Today, our fellow citizens, our way of life, our very freedom came under attack in a series of deliberate and deadly terrorist acts.
It's a very depressed, dismal, miserable mood. 100 year firemen, thousands of civilians are gone. As much, as quickly as you blow out a match, I go, flip a switch, I go. That's it. This building's came down. Go.
See them. It's hard to believe they're not there. They're not there.
This was my first reaction.
They're gone.
There is no more World Trade Center.
No.
It did happen, right? It's not something that I'm going to close my eyes and open them again and I'm going to see the tower, right? It's not there.
You know, and the only thing you have really, and the only thing that really kept it all together was us as a group, as a body, as a firehouse.
Around midnight, we sent Tony up to lower the flag to half-mast again.
There's going to be a lot of pain to deal with in the future. I have a pretty good friend who was in my academy class in my squad, who's among the missing. A lot of guys, we all lost friends and family.
I don't want to ever have to put that thing at half-mast again for the rest of my career.
Until the recall ends, it's 24 on, 24 off, 24 on, 24 off.
We got word that we'd start digging in the morning. Some of the guys with wives and kids went home just for a few hours. They knew it might be days before they'd see their families again.
and the kids came out, and we just kind of all cried in one big hug. And it was a we just cried.
Probably the best entrance I ever made to a place.
And I got home about 2 o'clock in the morning, hopped in the jacuzzi with my wife. But that's another story.
Came back to the firehouse the next day. I couldn't wait to get back, actually, because I wanted to get down there. I figured, well, we're going to have plenty of people that are going to be trapped, for sure. We're going to get them out. We always do.
I don't know if anyone's really pulled themselves together.
Focus on what you're doing today. I mean, time enough in a couple of weeks to really take in what happened to our guys. But today, you must focus on what you're doing. Go in teams of two. One guy falls through a hole, you're gonna have a guy there that knows you fell in that hole.
Let's take a ride with you.
We're all alive. That's more than we could have possibly hoped for. So our job now is to go and do whatever needs to be done and do it as much and as hard as we can for as long as they'll let us.
Some of the guys took a city bus down to what the media was already calling Ground Zero.
You guys got extra surgical gloves? You guys didn't put them in your pockets?
Some firemen called it the pile. For us, it was still the Trade Center, even if it was gone.
Hey, guys, you hear three horns? That means something might be coming down. So keep your eyes open when you're walking around down there.
Realize something that I always wanted to deny is how evil can be.
I need five firefighters, 19 and 12.
We went down there and formed up companies, five men and an officer.
Go, let's go.
We went to work right away, trying to look for survivors.
Try to get some buckets back here.
We're digging fast, passing those buckets quick. Digging frantically.
Bucket, empty bucket. Hey, watch your back, guys. Okay.
be digging, and all of a sudden everybody would say, quiet. And the whole place would get quiet and people would look. Slowly they would go back to work and start again. And that's how things went down there.
I remember the first time I went there was like, you know, gateway to hell.
Technically, Jules and Gédéon shouldn't have been anywhere near that site. It was dangerous enough for us firefighters. Every step you took, you could fall 30, 40 feet into a void. Jules and Gédéon said they had to be there, but not to film.
We would only take the camera and film for a few minutes. In fact, we forced ourselves to take the camera down because we just wanted to go there and help.
We'd clear what we could by hand. And the iron workers would come in, cut the steel beams and lift them out. Then we'd just start digging again.
You have two 110-story office buildings. You don't find a desk. You don't find a chair. You don't find a telephone, a computer. The biggest piece of a telephone I found was half of the keypad, and it was about this big. The building collapsed to dust. How are we supposed to find anybody in this, that there's nothing left of the building?
Bucket!
You find a little spot. And you just keep going and digging, and trying to find something. And you find a foot, and then they say the building's gonna collapse, and you run away.
Go, go, go!
Okay, okay.
And then we would go back. And mostly just dug. We found a body. It was a girl. She was dead. She was definitely dead. All her clothes had been burned off her. She looked to be pregnant. Some people thought maybe she was just bloated, but I don't think so. She was encased in rubble. And we had her about halfway uncovered and getting the body bag ready, and then they told us to run. And we ran. So I never got to see if they got her out. But would have felt good getting sayonara. At least I got one person out. One family will be able to have a decent funeral.
Our first shift was 24 hours, and in all that time, there was one person pulled out alive. One. It was beyond discouraging. it was even hard to understand. It was weird in a way. Walking back to the firehouse, people were cheering us. But we sure didn't feel like heroes. Every day, total strangers were showing up with supplies.
Somebody said that if you could still use towels, so okay, that's good. The end of the towels.
Thank you very much.
They opened up the doors, and lo and behold, deliveries were coming by the ton.
Kitchen? Or just go right around the corner, just dump them on the floor?
You can't eat all the cookies they're giving you.
No. I know it's early in the operation here, but I just wanted to thank everyone for all the hard work that they've been doing. How we're here, only God knows. But again, guys, thank you so much. You have no idea how much love I have.
Check the lockers, bro. Check the lockers, all the lockers, take whatever.
It's something special. You know, when guys are relentless, and just calling back and forth, guys with nails in their hand, taping it up, gashes, blood everywhere, just taping it up and saying, let's go back, let's see what we can do to make this situation a little better. There's gotta be people down there still alive, there has to be.
Listen, we try to keep hope. And we look everywhere. We even crawl down into the stores and the subway tunnels underneath the site. But as days turned into weeks, you began to accept there just wasn't anybody to find. But we never stopped looking.
Hey, Chief.
Yes, sir.
We got another body over here.
Firemen deal with ugly things every day. It's part of the job. But this was worse.
Get that body back!
Day after day, it pushed guys to their limit. Maybe past it.
A lot of guys don't know if they're gonna do the job anymore. I know it's either this or the Army now. And I like saving lives, I don't like taking them. But after what I saw, if my country decides to send me to go kill, I'll do it now.
Every night around dinner time, the fire department would put out a list of firefighters confirmed dead. And every night, that list got longer.
It is with regret that the department announces the deaths of the following members. Battalion Chief John P. Williamson. Firefighter William Henry. Firefighter Eric T. Allen. Firefighter Manuel Mojica. Firefighter Lawrence J. Virgilio. Firefighter Timothy Haskell. Firefighter Thomas P. Hannifin. Firefighter John A. Ventura. Firefighter Sean.
We lost so many people that everybody has lost dear friends, and not just one or two, but dozens.
Most days there was a memorial service for some guy you knew. Some days two or three, some days four. One of those services was for Kevin Pfeiffer, the chief's brother. He was last seen in the stairs of Tower 1, directing guys to the fastest way out of the building.
I would say that Chief Pfeiffer's brother saved my life. Saved a lot of lives.
And I remember walking down West Street and just remembering saying, you know, how much my brother and I used to love being downtown and doing this job. And how now I didn't love it anymore.
A few weeks passed, and we got new rigs. Well, used rigs, to replace Engine 7 and Ladder 1. They're still buried in there somewhere, under the pile. Eventually, we started going on runs again.
Feels good, though.
Playing pranks again. And trying our best to love the job again. But things will never be the way they were.
Every now and then still wonder, is it really true, you know? I know it happened, but I don't know. How do you deal with something like this? It's the 11th every day for me when I wake up. Did you want the new tape?
As for Jules and Gédéon, it's strange how things work out. In the beginning, they came to me and they said, let's make a documentary about a boy becoming a man during his 9-month probationary period. Turns out Tony became a man in about 9 hours, trying to help out on 9/11.
You know how you could tell that? He's not bragging about it.
It said to build. We were the only ones on the ticket. It said to build 1075.
Do I feel like it's given me more of a sense of self-worth? Yes. Has it made me a man? No. What's a man? You know, I'll still watch cartoons and do my stupid things. I'm just a person who tries to do good, just like every other person in the fire department.
For the fire department, now it's about rebuilding, somehow. At our firehouse, we've already got new probies to break in.
You get one chance to make a first impression.
Two guys fresh out of the academy. It's strange to think they'll never know what it was like to be a New York City fireman before September 11th. And they'll never really understand what we lost that day.
All we can do is tell them the stories and show them the tape.
A scholarship fund has been set up to support the families of New York City firefighters. Your donation can help shape a future. 9/11, presented by Nextel.
In the end, it's hard to weigh what happened on September 11th. You can measure some things, the height of a building, the size of its floors, the number of people who worked there. Bricks and steel are one thing, but human lives, you can't calculate that. Nearly 3,000 people died here on 9/11. Nearly 200 more at the Pentagon. Still more in the plane that crashed that day in Pennsylvania. You can add it up, but numbers don't do justice to what was really lost. Fathers and sons, wives, mothers and daughters. A lot of us watch stories like the one you've seen tonight and wonder what we can do. A scholarship fund has been set up to help the families of all New York firefighters. In a moment, we'll tell you how you can help. There are many people still working here at Ground Zero. It's now hallowed ground. So every day, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, the work goes on, in the hope that it'll give the families of those who were lost some peace. People have asked us why we wanted to show this material. Part of it was history, but the other part is personal. The men who shot this material wanted the world to see this moment in history as they saw it. Not a moment of terror, but one of strength. When good men did great things, tens of thousands were saved by simple acts of courage. We hope that will be the true legacy of the men from Engine 7, Ladder 1. It's the legacy of all those who are on duty tonight and every night, men and women waiting for a chance to answer the call in tribute to all those who lost their lives on 9/11. I'm Robert De Niro. Good night.
Danny boy, the boy. They laid down their lives for strangers. They were inspired by their sense of duty and their love for humanity.
They did not live to know who had caused the destruction or why. They only knew their duty, and that was to go in, to follow the faintest cry, to search for the trapped and helpless, and to save those who could be saved.
And when you come, and all the flowers are dying, and I am dead, as dead I well may be, you'll come and find the place where I am lying, and kneel and say, I know. And I shall hear the song.